Hi, this is Gene DiNapoli. Just want to let you know that your comments tonight might be shown on screen.
Gentlemen, Gene DiNapoli.
Hi, everybody, and welcome to Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli. Once again, it is Monday, and once again, I'm still Gene DiNapoli. Tonight is our 37th episode. I was hoping when I started this series back in August, I'd get through a month. Here we are, 37 episodes in, and tonight, I could bet your bottom dollar you're going to enjoy it. But first, a word from our sponsors.
Hi, my name is Howard, and along with my partner Karen, we are Cruise Planners Dream Destinations Travel. Contrary to the name, we are a full-service travel agency specializing in individual, multi-generational, and group vacations. Certified with all major cruise lines, we are also represent all resorts and all-inclusives throughout the beautiful Caribbean and Mexico. Let us build your dream vacation. Please call us at 347-398-8653 for a free, no-obligation quote.
Little Italy Auto Repair at 628 Crescent Avenue in the true Little Italy of the Bronx. Over 50 years of automotive service excellence, ASC and state certified, offering all types of services to all types of cars. Discounts to first responders, military, Fordham University students and faculty. All work is done by Victorio with the highest level of quality possible. Telephone number is 718-933-2365 or visit his website at www.littleitalyautobronx.webs.com. That's Little Italy Auto Repair.
Hi, this is Francisco. Many people call me the creative CPA. If you need help with your taxes or financial matters, please email me your cell number and the best time and day to call you. You can email me at francisco@aol.com, and Cisco is spelled S-I-S-C-O, the creative CPA. It's that simple, that easy. Thank you.
Thank you to our sponsors. In addition to watching our show on Facebook and YouTube, you could also listen to the audio of our shows on ItalianAmericanRadio.com and HamiltonRadio.com. And we want to thank them for thinking so much of our show that they let it be heard out to the masses. Before we get into the show, I want to dedicate tonight's show to a very special man who had gained his wings this morning. I'm talking about one of the greatest performers that I've ever come in contact with from a group called The Regents, talking about our good friend Ron Anthony. You might have heard of a song called Barber Ann. Well, Ron, along with the rest of the guys, kept that song alive. Such a great song, recorded by the Beach Boys. And from what I heard, the Beatles wanted to do it as well. So, Ron, God bless you. And we will miss you. A nicer guy, I don't think we would have known. This Wednesday marks the first birthday of my dear friend Pepe Cardona in heaven. So we want to wish you the best, Pepe. We love you and we miss you. So the past 36 shows have dealt with Elvis Presley, who everybody knows I'm an Elvis fanatic, doo-wop, oldies, pop, and rock of the 50s to middle 60s. And tonight, we are going to go into a foray of a realm, which I'd like to lie to you and say I knew a lot about, but I'm not going to lie. I didn't know a lot about this music. I knew a lot about this man and the group because when you talk about power quartets, they're in the top. When you talk about East Coast keeping America on the charts, this group is there. When you talk about psychedelic sounds meeting old good songs and making anthems, you know, everybody credits Meatloaf and Jim Steinman with creating anthems. Well, this man and his group, his fellow musicians, were the first at taking 3-minute songs and making them masterpieces. Tonight, you're going to meet and get to know the author of this book, Psychedelic Solo. And before we get him in, I want you to just hear some of this man's accomplishments. Besides having a number 2 record in the country, right behind the Beatles, his guitar riff on that song was voted the top 4th song riff by Rolling Stone magazine and Guitar magazine. I think that's pretty good to be 4 out of thousands of guitar riffs. His latest CD, Endless High, talk about, I mean, you got 8 or 9 songs, but no song is less than 4 minutes. Some of these songs are 9 minutes and 8 minutes. You're going to get so engrossed. And then to boot, he goes back to college, which he hated school. If you read this book, you would realize how much this man hated school. Then he goes back to college at what I'm going to say is 30 or 35 years old, maybe, and gets his degree. And more importantly, ladies and gentlemen, he is a United States Naval veteran. So will you please welcome into the room tonight to Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli, fellow Italian, fellow Bronxite, Mr. Vincent Martamucci, also known as Mr. Vince Martell of Vanilla Fudge. Let's bring in Vince. Come on in, Vince.
How you doing, guys?
Thanks. Hey, Vince. Oh, it's so good for you to be. Vince, when was this picture taken? Yesterday? Because you look the same.
Thank you. Yeah, no, that's probably taken 4 or 5 years ago, maybe now.
I look at the pictures in your book, and except for the hair getting a little longer, you look the same. You look the same. It's remarkable.
Hey, I'm into the good Lord. What can I tell you? Maybe that's the key. I don't know, but thank you.
I think it's a little bit of the good Lord, a little bit of your service to our country, and a lot of cannolis, maybe.
Yeah, well, that's for sure. I'm Italian, like you said.
Yes, an Italian from the Bronx.
Northeast Bronx, you know?
Northeast Bronx, absolutely. You know, at the beginning of your book, Vince, you made a remark that you're a private person. Yet, reading your book over the past week, I seem to have gotten to know you in a way that maybe people that know you 30 years plus don't know you. You really opened up your life and your heart and your mind in this book. Was it as easy to write or to dictate as it was to read?
Well, I don't know, but I wanted to, give everybody a chance to see that, we all go through crazy stuff in life and things you like, things you don't like, things you have to do, whatever it is. And just keep persevering on. And I kind of enjoy doing it because I relived my whole life again by redoing the book, you know. So I had a good time doing it, and I figured maybe it'll help somebody else somewhere along the line.
Absolutely. But, and what I think is important, Vince, is to you're a rock and roll star, yet you never lost sight of your upbringing, your family values. You went through some metamorphoses with religion. You tried different religions, whatever worked best for you. And you came full circle.
Okay, thanks. You know,
yeah.
That's what it's about. What can I say?
Yeah, absolutely.
You find out, you know, what direction you want. What do you want to do with your life? We're all passing through. So you want to try to accomplish something of some meaningful value and to help some people out and to do what you were meant to do over here before you get out of here, because maybe you can't come back and change nothing next time. You know what I'm saying?
Right. And although you knew at a very young age, your parents were both into the music arts. Mom played the mandolin as well as dad. Am I correct?
Yeah, they both played. Well, my mother played mandolin and guitar.
Right.
My father played guitar and violin. And my sister played piano, all the classical. I grew up hearing all the classical music that you'd ever want to hear. I grew up with that. So, yeah, I've been around all my relatives. My grandparents played, my aunts, my cousins. Everybody in my family plays music.
Right. What's great about your story is that at an early age, you knew what you wanted to do, but you also knew what you didn't want to do. And you didn't want to immerse yourself in studies that weren't going to live your dream.
Well, yeah, talking about schooling.
Yeah.
I guess, you know, what it is, I think everybody's talented in some way or other. And if you can find what you love to do, again, if the Lord will give you a couple of hints along the way, then you'll be most happy. And it's like you never work a day in your life if you can do what you love to do, as opposed to something that you have to do that maybe you care for so much. You got to find what you love, go after that.
Maybe that's why you continue to look the effervescent 25 years old in today's day and age. I got to tell you, I've read a lot of books since I started the show, but your book has the distinction of being the only book with a family crest in this book. This is the Martamucci family crest, everybody. So did you, do you have this on your wall, or was it something you had done for the book?
No, I have one downstairs in the house. We have it up on a wall, and my father found out about it because he came from Italy. So he turned us on to that, and it's something that we cherished our whole family life, and we wanted to, that's why I put it in the book, because it's a beautiful thing. It's, and my father pronounces our name Martamucci. So that's, you know, what's going on with that. And my father was somebody, if you read in the book, you would never cross him. Heavy duty man of respect. And whatever he said was law. So, you know, and I appreciate that now. When I was growing up, it was a little rough toeing the line there. You had to be careful. If you did something wrong, don't let him find out. But I appreciate everything that both of my parents have done for me.
You're very proud of your family because in the photo section, Vince, with a career spanning close to 50 years, I'm going to assume you have thousands of photos, yet half the photos in your book are of your family members before you got into music. And I think that's wonderful that you think so much of your grandmother, Lugina, your Uncle Frank, Uncle Benny, to include them in this book in such a prolific way, I think is a testament to your upbringing. So really proud of that fact. And your parents should be very proud.
Thank you so much. Yeah, I am very proud of my parents because I have four uncles that were in the service, that were in World War II. And my family was very upstanding, patriotic. And I grew to love that. And that's why I joined the Navy at 17 for that reason. I couldn't wait to go in after hearing Victory at Sea on TV and my uncles talking about their experiences. One of my uncles, Uncle Frank, was in the Battle of the Bulge.
Yes.
My Uncle Ed Filomeno was up in the Aleutian Islands. Another uncle was on a tin can. The other one was in the army. So I'm very patriotic, like you just said.
Yeah. Absolutely. And we'll get to your work with the veterans that you still continue to do a little later on in the interview. But, you know, it's funny how your first band that you were involved with took the name of the New York State, especially the Bronx bird. The national bird of the Bronx is called the pigeon. And that was the name of your first band, right?
Yeah, that was the first one that got some notoriety. And it was given to us by a guy by the name of Jeff Barry, who was a mogul of some sort in the music business. And I guess because the birds were out there and the Beatles and different bands, so they decided to let's call us something to do with the animals, the birds of some sort. So we became the pigeons. And, you don't want to say no when you're coming up to the different people in the business. No, I don't want to do this. No, I don't want to do that. It's not that cool. You got to kind of go along to some degree with the program, you know?
Right. Right. And the first song that caused, that ruffled some feathers, if I may make a joke, by the Pigeons was a song called Don't Look Back. And we're going to play a little bit for our viewers and listeners. Here's Vince Martell and the Pigeons, Don't Look Back. Fabulous. Fabulous. Now, that was a Temptation song. Am I right?
Yes.
Yes. That was a Temptation song.
We had an opportunity to do it. In that band, that we had Mark Stein, who was doing the singing, beautiful job. We had Tim Bogart on bass, who just recently passed away. Fantastic bass player, the top five in the world. We had a great drummer named Joey Brennan, who's the first guy that got in touch with me that I got to know these guys, and myself. That was the Pigeons group.
Right. You got to be crazy to listen to that and not hear the Rascals. Do you kind of feel that way, that you took heavy off the Rascals vocals and you added it to your original sound? Yeah.
Sure we did. We picked up from everybody. We had, when we first got together, we went out to the place called The Eye in Long Island in the Hamptons, and we saw a group called The Vagrants, who were the biggest group in New York at the time, playing at the Scott Muni's place and making big money without a single. They were doing great. And between their stage show that we saw and then the Rascals, we saw them at the phone booth. And between these, and there was a lot of other groups actually doing that kind of stuff, big productions. That's where we decided to get into it. Big production numbers.
Right. And talking about big production numbers, you took another Motown song. You threw psychedelic sounds, you threw orchestrations in it, and your first release out of the gate goes to number two all over the country. We're talking about the great song, You Keep Me Hanging On. Anthony, let's show the people what the real psychedelic rock was like. Wow. I really wish we could play more than just 30 seconds for our viewers and listeners, but that's what it's supposed to entice them. So they go to your website and they buy your CD or they download your songs to hear the full version. Now, is it true that You Keep Me Hanging On is the longest intro before anybody sings?
I don't know about that, but we didn't really look to make it long. We just were, the way we were orchestrating the pieces was just to get the most emotion as we possibly could out of the arrangement. And that's basically what happened with that. But let me back up 1 second, if I may. The song went to number two in England under the Beatles. It was just the Beatles was number one. We were number two in England. We went to number six over here in the U.S., but in Philly, we were number two in Philly. Oh. So, you know, it made a lot of noise. I tell you, we had fantastic management.
Yeah, you with Ahmet Adegan, a visionary for his time. Absolutely, yeah. With Atlantic. Do you happen to remember what the number one song was in England when you were number two? Do you happen to recollect that?
Be honest with you, I never thought about it, but now that you mentioned it, I should look into it and find out. And I wasn't paying attention to that stuff at the time, I guess.
Right. So now, you before you had the hit, you did a lot of club work. A lot of club work, right?
Yes, a whole lot.
Up and down the East Coast, Choo Choo Club, where Joey D and the Rascals got their start, all the way out in Long Island under Phil Bazile. You must have done a good 200 shows in your first year.
Well, we did so many gigs in the 3 years from 67 to 70. We did so many gigs that we had maybe two-week periods off. The rest of it was gigs all over the place. We played all over the place. You know, they got us, you know, playing in Europe, all over. It was just, you know, a whirlwind of tours.
Did you like the touring, Vinny?
Did I like recording or touring?
Touring. Did you like touring?
Yes, I liked it. Yeah, it was very nice. I mean, you get to see exotic places that you wouldn't have normally gone to. You're treated like a king. When we were in England, we were riding around in Rolls Royces like the Beatles. We pulled up to the couple of the clubs that we played with, and they had the people outside, you know, just like you see in the movies.
Right.
We go running in, and they're keeping the kids away from us. Like, and it was, you know, it was very intense.
Yeah. We have a listener from California who just said the top three New York sounding groups, the Rascals, the Vagrants, and Vanilla Fudge. I got to agree with that.
Yeah, thank you, Tello.
Yeah, absolutely. I read in your book, which I did not know, was that when you did the Ed Sullivan Show, you actually recorded your performance to run simultaneously on tape in case the live feed went out.
Exactly. Yeah, that's how they run that show. The first day you go, and it's like 3 days. The first day you go in, and you're in street clothes, and they talk you through what they expect you to do. You stand where you would stand, and they get a rough idea of what you're going to do. The second day you go in there dressed as if you're doing the show, and they record it, and you do the whole show. You know, you do your song, whatever you're going to perform, and they record the whole thing. They video it. And then the third day, which is the Sunday that everybody sees it live, you do the exact same song, the exact same way. And in the back, they're running the machines concurrently. So if there's a mishap of some sort, they switch, throw a switch, and the people, audience watching TV, nobody misses a beat. The only people who are going to see a difference is the people in the studio at that particular point. It's like a safety, a fail-safe.
Right. Now, you know, I had known about that technique because when Elvis Presley played in Hawaii in 1973, they did a rehearsal show 2 days before, which they videotaped. He did the exact same songs in order, and then they ran that along with the live. But you're talking about a monumental concert. You don't mind spending money on that. Was this an every week occurrence for Ed Sullivan? Did they do that every week? Was that the norm?
I believe that, you know, I don't know, but I would think that this is how they ran all their shows for the performers. They probably did something like that. Maybe they didn't do it for the comedians and some of the other people, but for the music, that's what they did.
Right, right. And let's put a rumor to rest. Give us the real way Vanilla Fudge was named, because there's everybody takes liberties and say, yeah, I was out and blah, blah. What is from Vince Martell's mouth? Who came up with the name Vanilla Fudge?
That came up from a girl that was where we were rehearsing at a place called the Action House, Phil Basile's place in Long Island. And she was from a group called the Unspoken Word. And she happened to come walking into the back room where we were talking, the office. And we had been trying to come up with a name change from the Pigeons for a long time. And she heard us discussing that. And she was eating ice cream. And her nickname was Vanilla Fudge, that her grandfather named her. So she said, what about Vanilla Fudge? And it was one of those things that nobody shot it down. Up until then, you come up with a name, somebody would shoot it down. They didn't like this. They didn't like that. This one, nobody shot down. And we started thinking about it, like Blue Eyed Soul or something like that, Soul Brothers. And everybody liked it. So that's, you know, thanks to her from the group The Unspoken Word.
Yeah, well, thank you, Didi. I'm gonna play on your memory again. Do you remember some of the names that you turned down? Do you remember some of the names that were kicked around?
Be honest with you, I don't, because there were so many names that came and went. Somebody would say it, and somebody didn't like it. It wasn't something I stuck in my mind to remember. But we didn't really care about, you know, the Pigeons' name. We didn't really like that much. So we were game for anything. You know?
Well,
we kind of seemed to do a good, we liked it.
I think it worked. And you actually recorded a song called While the World Was Eating Vanilla Fudge. Am I correct?
Well, that was the Pigeons album. After the Vanilla Fudge came out, then the record company that recorded the Pigeons, which had basically put us on the shelf, which they do that a lot of times in a business. They'll record you and then they'll... So they, after Vanilla Fudge started making noise, then they decided to put it out. And that's While the World Was Eating Vanilla Fudge and featuring the Pigeons.
That's great. That's great. I noticed you put your guitar down, so I'm going to impose on you to please pick it up because you are one of the few guests who offered to do a live impromptu. And you're going to do a song that you did a lot in your shows. And you said you love this because of the gospel inflections. We're talking about the great tune, People Get Ready. Are you doing this solo or are you doing it with your lovely wife, Peg?
I'll do it with my lovely wife, Peg, if she All wants right. to do it. All right. One, two, one, two. Okay.
This is Peg is Vince's wife, who's also a New York girl from Queens. So this is Vince and Peg Martell in okay. a acoustic.
Okay, it's Peg Pearl.
Peg Pearl.
Because she had a beautiful career going out in Denver before we ever got together. But we'll do the song for you. Thank you. There ain't no room for the holy shit. Not a hurt all mankind.
Save his own.
I pity on fools with chances for better parts. There's hope for all among the kingdom's stars. There ain't no room for the sinners, not a hurt of mankind.
Save his own.
Have pity on those chances for better hopes. There's hope for all among the kingdom's stars. That's what I'm talking about. Don't need no ticket. You just thank the Lord. That's all you gotta do.
Wow, fabulous. Fabulous. Hey, Peg, don't you go nowhere. I want to look at you for the next hour. You stay right there. So, of course, that was done by the great, great Curtis Mayfield. But right. I got a feeling your arrangement is a little bit of the Jeff Beck Martell version. Love that harmony. Whose idea was that to put those notes in there?
I guess we collaborate together. Peg is, has a music degree. And,
yeah, this is pre-Jeff Beck, FYI.
Pre-Jeff Beck. So, Peg, I got to ask you something. You had your own career, Vincent mentioned. I'm going to assume back in the 90s, because you don't look mature enough to be around in the 70s.
You're right. My mom had the records.
Your mom had the records, yes. So when you were doing your thing, what type of material did you do?
It was a very progressive heavy rock, a lot of orchestrations. I play keyboard as well. So it's very driving with a
really
high-pitched voice to set the heavy music.
Yeah. And what was the name of your project, your group?
It's called Aura.
Aura?
Aura.
And you were based out of Queens?
Nope, Denver.
Denver? Okay. All right. So when you met Vince, did you know of his abilities and about his showmanship?
I knew of Vanilla Fudge, but I was actually in Denver when I was connected with him. Wow. And a quick story, my dad was always looking for me to make it. So he found an article in the Denver Post, an ad for a producer in New York looking for singer-songwriters. I submitted a tape. He loved it. And he said, you know, what are you doing in Denver? There's no music scene there. And it happened to be Don Cassell, who was the engineer of the first Vanilla Fudge album. And that's kind of how we got together.
Really? Wow. Too. That's fabulous. So you know why I ask that question, Peg, is because I don't know if you remember a guy named Sean Cassidy.
I've heard of
Sean Cassidy was a 70s teen idol, sold millions of posters, had four or five hits. Well, when he met his wife, his current wife, she thought he was a producer. Like she had no idea he was on American Bandstand. So she says to him, why do you have gold records? She goes, why? He's why I used to be a singer. So I kind of like ask when people meet, whether it's male, female, I ask them, do they know? But that's a great story. So can we find any of your stuff online under Aura?
No. It was basically live music. We were on the radio. And I mean, right. I have recordings of it. If I want to put them, I can do them. Yeah.
Well, he has sang some harmony on some Vanilla Fudge recordings.
So yeah, I'm the only girl on the Spirit of 67 Vanilla Fudge album.
Is that a fact?
That is a fact.
Wow. All right, you know what? You're too talented. Go away.
I'm like, going away. Thank you. Away. God
bless. Me and Vince. You'll be back in a little bit.
Okay.
So, Vince, I got to tell you, I love the fact that you relied heavily on songs by other artists that Vanilla Fudge made their own. Shotgun. Tell us about Shotgun.
Well, Shotgun was something that Timmy sang. He wanted it. Timmy was a very driving musician. Like I said earlier, fantastic bassist and a singer, great singer. And he wanted to do that. And I think that actually, you know, the Junior Walker song that Joey Brennan, the first guy that was in the Pigeons, the original drummer from the Pigeons before we got the Great Carmine Appice on there, was the guy that suggested some Junior Walker stuff for Timmy, because we used to do all R&B when we were doing the Choo Choo Club. Mm. We did all R&B stuff. And that's it. Timmy launched into it, and I got a chance to do my wah-wah pedal.
Right.
And, you know, as a matter of fact, there's an article this month in Vintage Guitar Magazine, and the guy asked me that exact same thing about the wah-wah pedal. It's one of the things I talked about in this. So if anybody wants to pick that up, but it just was a drive, you know, the Fudge is a very driving band besides doing big orchestrations and, you know, the great Mark Stein with his vocal ability. Besides that, we also like to get out and just rock, you know?
Right.
So that's kind of what we did. We do that in our shows. We do heavy rock. We do big orchestrations. We do moods. We do Season of the Witch. We yes. do, you know, all kinds of stuff like that.
Yes, and rock you do, anyway, especially on this. What?
Yes, I wanted to say, not to cut you off.
That's okay.
But the Timmy and Carmine were known as like the best drummer and bass player in rock. And they were like two players with one heartbeat. So.
Well, that's what makes a great marriage between the bass and the drum.
You got it. Yeah. Got to have that heavy backbeat. And Timmy was always watching Carmine's foot. And the two of them, you know, they took off and they worked with everybody. Jeff Beck,
Dean,
all kinds of people. Right. Like, great careers.
Speaking of Shotgun, we're going to let our listeners hear the driving beat of a Junior Walker classic, a la Fudge. Anthony, hit it.
Thank you. Yeah.
Video 3, Anthony. Okay. Did you guys ever do ballads? How'd you keep up this pace? What'd you do, like a 90-minute show and everything was driving, 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 driving?
Well, we don't always do a 90-minute show. It depends on, you know, what is booked for the venue. We do a 60, we do a 75, and then we could do a 90, and sometimes we do two shows. But, we did Some Velvet Morning. If the listeners ever get a chance to hear that, we won the Golden Gondola in Italy when we did that.
Yes.
But to give you an idea of our, I got to attribute the people behind the scenes that sometimes don't get any credit or don't get enough credit. Our management was terrific. When we played Venice, Italy, we were the only group from the United States of America. We were the only rock and roll group. And we ended up being one of the winners. It was us, it was the Elvis of France at the time, and it was somebody else. Everybody, all the acts, this was like a three-day affair out there in Venice, which is a fantastic place to visit if anybody gets a chance. We took a train from Milano. What a beautiful train this was. Everything was bright, polished, and shined up, wood, varnished, fantastic. Then you get off the train at the end of the stop in Venice, and they have these beautiful boats that are all painted also. I mean, it's like a dream world. And you go over to the main island, and it was 3 days. Everybody was in tuxedos and gowns, and we were the only guys rock and roll. We had Marshall amps. They had orchestras behind them. And we went on, all the orchestras go there, pulled the Marshall amps up and everything. And that was fantastic. We had, ended up having dinner with Domenico Modugno, who did Volare.
Yes.
And, you know, it's just like a paid vacation. I'm telling you, it's just wonderful.
You know, Vinny, in your book, Psychedelic Solo, you recount when you met Domenico Modugno, and you said that it took you back to your father's butcher shop hearing that song. So I got to ask you, when you find, well, you were a working musician, but when you wound up on Ed Sullivan, mom and dad were still with us. So you went to the house the next day, and were you Vince Martell TV star, or were you Vince Martell take out the garbage?
Well, actually, I wasn't really living home at that point. When the group started touring, I moved from the Bronx to Long Island, Island Park, because the manager had the place called the Action House, which we played a lot if we weren't doing other gigs up and down the East Coast, whatever. And it was easier when we did have gigs out of town for us to all congregate at the Action House, jump in one car, go to the airport and fly out, rather than me from the Bronx, Carmine from Brooklyn, Timmy from Ridgefield, Mark from Bayonne. So we ended up, you know, moving out like that. So when I want to say with the Domenico Modugno thing, what was intense about that is I had been going to summer school at that point. So I'd come back from summer school, take the train, get off of my father's butcher shop, Marlin Meat Market on Allerton Avenue, right by White Plains Road. And I'd be in the back and, you know, my father wanted me to study, but I wasn't really the book guy. So I'd be out parking the other butcher's cars. They let me move the cars around. I knew I liked that. And but Domenico Modugno, when he came on, that was a big, big thing. So, you know, it's both, I guess. It was a little bit of being home again when the Fudge was off tour. I'd visit the folks. But at that point, I had my own place. I was out. But I was always, you know, their son. I wasn't like big highfalutin because I had some fantastic opportunities come my way.
Okay. But mom and dad, they were very proud. Your mother, she put a lot into your early lessons. You used to go to Manhattan on two buses and a train. They really nurtured your talent. So I guess it was rewarding for them to see you do what you love and to be recognized.
Oh, it sure was. Yeah, my sister, like I said earlier, took piano lessons. So we had been driving her on Saturdays for her lessons. And then I took different lessons. And when I did the one with all the trains, because before that I was up in Hillside on Boston Post Road between East Chester Road and Gun Hill Road, doing some lessons there. But then I went to Harry Volpe in New York City, and that's the one where we'd have to take the Dyer Avenue train to 180th Street down to 42nd or 52nd and get off and take lessons from Harry Volpe. So when the group took off, it was, I guess, great satisfaction for them that but we used to see Ed Sullivan on TV when I was a kid.
Right.
You know, we'd be in my grandmother's house after eating a fantastic big dinner. And we would have to, you know, go in the living room and be quiet because my father had to sleep. And we'd watch Ed Sullivan and the other shows that were on, you know, Lincoln Mercury, this, that, you know, whatever. So it was great. What can I say? That's why I did it in the book. I had to put it all down and let some other people, you know, enjoy it. And I got my folks a trip to Italy and to Europe with some of the money from the Fudge and, you know, stuff like that. I had to pay them back. I had beautiful parents.
That's great. I notice, maybe because I'm from the Bronx well, but some of the characters in my life mirror some of them in yours. I'm talking about Phil Bazile. You had a cousin Carmine who had to go to bat for you a few times.
My cousin Sonny.
Cousin Sonny.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were really, it was really an eye-opening part of the book when you talk about the album you were doing. And then, you went to a club. You went to the China Club and you couldn't get in. and you made a phone call. Within 5 minutes, you had ringside table.
Oh, I'll tell you, man. My cousin was, you know, it's like this, you know, with respect to everybody, the management was, you know, one group, and my cousin, they were in another group from the city. They kind of ran New York City.
Mm-hmm.
And so anyway, what happened is, you know, when I couldn't get into the China Club, because the bouncers didn't know who I was, me and my cousin Mike, who looked like John Gotti Jr., you know, just had a similar appearance. And when we couldn't get in, we made this call to my cousin Sonny up at Rayo's, this restaurant up there on 114th Street. And he says, like I said in the book, I mean, I don't want to tell the whole book. You
know, yeah.
You don't do the whole thing. But we got in, like, we were treated like kings from then on.
What I love was that you went up to the bouncer and you said, I'm Vince Martell from the Vanilla Fudge. And he looked at you like he had four heads. That was the best.
Well, you know, the bouncers was probably too young. They didn't know. Whatever it is. But when they get the call from somebody, I guess the manager of the place,
right?
When my cousin made that call, the manager told, or rather, he got right to the owner. The owner got the manager, so the manager came up and told the bouncers, and we barely got across the street, and we were, you know, ushered in. It was really something. Sure. Like out of the movies, I'm telling you.
It, like out of Goodfellas with the Copa.
Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
So, Vin, there was another part of the book. Everybody, you got to get this book. Anthony, come back to the book. You got to get this book. It is a great 260-some-odd page read. But, Vin, what I love, and I got to be honest with you, how did you keep all these clippings and all these show posters of a majority of your gigs? Are you a collector?
No, I'm not. Actually, I had some people, a guy named Stan Vaughn, who was a fantastic fan who has since passed away, a wonderful man and his wife. He was a fantastic collector of all this stuff. And when I told him I was doing a book, he says, Vinny, if you want any of the posters I got, you know, for your book, let me know and I'll give them to you, you know, for the book. So I always want to credit him for that. He was a wonderful guy. And, you know, he passed away. But
right.
He's a friend of Pete Bremner that is playing bass with the Fudge right at the moment.
Right.
Since Timmy.
We want to thank Stan for collecting these. And I want to thank our mutual friend Michelangelo for putting it this interview between us together. Michelangelo from There You Have It Productions. We want to thank him. You know, there's one poster in your book, and I don't know if anybody caught this. The Pop Music Festival in Alberta, Canada, when you played with Frank Zappa and a new group called the Motors of Invention. Yeah. Nobody caught this.
The Mothers, yeah, Mothers of Invention, yeah, Frank Zappa. But, you know, yeah, we did, you know, a bunch of things all over. Like I said, we played all over. I think we played... there might be a typo on that particular poster. If
there is.
Oh, okay.
That's why I said the motors of invention.
Yeah, we did a gig with him at the, let me see, what's the name of that place in Long Island? Round.
Westbury.
Westbury Music Fair. My light just went off on my phone over here.
Okay.
We can get this back on. Oh, oops. Mike, are we still on?
Oh. No, you froze.
Okay,
we're close.
All right.
Okay.
Peggy's going to try to get this back on. But,
okay. Yeah, there you are.
Okay, I think she got it. Yeah. We did something at Westbury Music Fair with the Mothers of Invention. And it was a weird gig. I'll never forget it because, you know, people have been at a stage revolves. And the Mothers went on first. We were headlining everybody. And like I said, fantastic management. So before we went on, Frank Zappa and his group came walking down. They all had like sheets on of some sort. They're like monks. And they all came down the different stairs around this whole place playing flutes and horns and stuff like that. And Togas. Pegas told me it's Togas. Anyway, Togas. We all came down the stairs playing instruments. It was very, they were all dissonant sounding music going on, and it was very ethereal. And then when they hit the stage, then they launched into their thing. But I'll never forget the move that they set up for us was heavy duty. It was weird. You know, it was cool.
Wow. That's great. Now, I know you did a lot of Beatles. You have the respect, and you covered a lot of their songs. We're going to play a video now of one of my favorite Beatles songs. Anthony, next video would be, what would that be? Video 4, Ticket to Ride.
Oh, yeah.
Great stuff. Great stuff. On page 197, Vinny, you list a partial list of some of the groups you were on tour with. I'm just going to rattle off the top 10. Rolling Stones, Yardbirds, Three Dog Night, Simon and Garfunkel, Santana, The Birds, The Who, Janis Joplin, The Doors, Cream, Allman Brothers. Now, that's all well and good that you were on these shows, but it must have been something really rewarding when you got to jam out with B.B. King.
Oh, yeah, man. Well, you know, the story behind that is we were offered to do Woodstock. And the management said, you know, well, what are they paying? And they weren't really paying. And so they passed that. We passed on it. But, of course, we didn't know it was going to be the biggest thing of the century, but we'd have passed on it. But that night, Woodstock started. We were doing a gig with B.B. King and Joe Cocker. And we were up in Connecticut, and I was going to do Woodstock. I drove there in my new Corvette, 68 Ford Corvette, 427, four-speed hot car. And Mark Stein had himself a Vette also. And there was some instruments with B.B. King's band. They ran into a car problem. B.B. showed up, but his band didn't show up, and we ended up backing up B.B. King. And so the other guys backed him up there for a while, and then he called me up because I'm on the side there. So I ended up getting up with him and jamming out on whatever. We did some kind of a blues something, and he gave me a beautiful compliment. And I got nothing but respect for the guy.
You played with the king. You played with the king.
Yep, you got it.
At the top of the show, I called you a power quartet, because you all played instruments, but that you're a power quartet. It is what it is. But you worked with a power trio who set the standard for everybody else after them. We're talking about Led Zeppelin. And you did an album, or at least a few songs, of Led Zeppelin songs. So we're going to play a little bit of one of their biggest hits. And then I want you to come back and tell us a story about working with Led Zeppelin. Anthony, hit the video. Led Zeppelin. So you did some good dates with them. Matter of fact, when they started, they were your opening act.
Exactly, yeah, because when they came over to the U.S., they wanted to break into the U.S. market. And my manager was running Concerts East at the time, and we gave them a break. So what happened is we let them open up for us, and they did in a bunch of gigs out for Concerts, actually Concerts West, not Concerts East, Concerts West. And we let them open up for us at a bunch of gigs. In the meantime, we had been touring so much that we were kind of like, we needed a break. We should have taken a break somewhere in the offing, and we didn't. And so when they got on the scene, we had already started being into some fist fights with each other and stuff. But you gotta get away from each other a little bit. We didn't do it enough. So we took our break, and they took off, you know, with Peter Grant. They took off, and our management again was involved with Concerts West, so they became the biggest group in the world. You know, God bless them.
Yeah. Sometimes the student learns a lot from the master, and then they become the master themselves.
That's right. By the way, what you just saw, the video everybody just saw is, well, we got to deal with Golden Robot. We have some great management out of California again now, and we have a deal on Golden Robot Records. And if people want to see that video, all they got to do is put in Immigrant Song, Vanilla Fudge, Golden Robot. And if I may add to that, that's a single that they put out, and they just put out a second single, Rock and Roll, because we did a whole album, Out Through the Indoor, in honor of the Zeppelin, since we gave them a break and got them started over here. So we ended up doing a whole album, and one of the songs we did is their rendition of Rock and Roll featuring me singing it, and the record company Golden Robot just put that out. So that's something else, and we're working on other stuff with them, so hopefully things will, you know, keep moving.
As long as they move forward, they're always moving.
You got it.
Richie Blackmore once said that because of Vanilla Fudge, Deep Purple came to be.
Yeah. That's nice. I'm glad, you know, to hear. We got accolades from everybody in the business. And as a matter of fact, he just got a copy of my book for his birthday. A friend of his asked me if, you know, he wanted to send him a book. So I signed the book to Richie. And he's another great guitarist. A lot of great musicians out there. A lot of great players.
Right. Right. You released 5 albums in the span of just under 2 years. Am I correct?
Yes.
Were those all songs that were in the can that they sporadically released, or did you keep going back in the studio?
Yeah, we kept going back in the studio. As a matter of fact, we had a fantastic producer, George Shadow Morton, who did the Shangri-Las and Janice Ian and Leader of the Pack. And he wanted us to stay in the studio. We did our first album, and when we did our first album, we were on a very creative roll. And we also did Season of the Witch at that particular point. And then they decided to hold it for the next album. Now, what they decided is to do a concept album. George Shadow Morton and Ahmet Erdogan wanted to do a concept album. So we did the second album, which was The Beat Goes On, which some people love and some people don't, because it wasn't all just rock and roll. It was a whole history of music through time kind of thing like that. But it's got some Beethoven Feralies and Moonlight Sonata, which is beautiful. And I'd like to get the guys to start doing some of that in concert again. But anyway, then the third album, we went in the studio and we did a lot of originals. And we did all creative stuff. So that's it. Then the fourth album, Near the Beginning, we did a bunch of other stuff. So we'd go back in and out of the studio to record. But once you're out of the studio the first time, once you're on that creative roll, I suggest to all upcoming groups, stay there and get a couple of albums worth of stuff under your belt. So in case it takes off like it did for us on the first one, you got plan B ready right behind you before you might get into a different aspect.
Right, right. What album was Bang Bang off of?
Bang Bang would be the first album.
First album, right?
Yep.
Another great song. Anthony, let's roll the videotape. You know, every instrument in your group was like an ingredient, and you put it all together and you wound up with a great sauce.
You're right. I totally agree with you. We had great players, great musicians, great management, great record company, great producer, great lawyer. We had everything was going. It was the dream team.
That's a great way to say it. You had said that I had brought up the Rascals, but you had talked about Blue-Eyed Soul. that might have been one of your names. And I noticed that one of your covers, another great song, is by one of the greatest blue-eyed soul duos, the Righteous Brothers. You guys did a cover of You're My Soul and Inspiration.
Oh, I think that's from the Pigeons when we first... Yeah.
But I like that so much. So we're going to play a little bit. We're going full circle. Vin, Anthony, You're My Soul. Call it the Pigeons, call it Vanilla Fudge. I call it great music. I call it great music. And which continues, Vin, with, you know, this CD is a little bit older now, but Endless High. I mean, you're talking, you even do Stevie Wonder on this CD.
Oh, yeah, man. That's when I got a chance to sing and belt it out. And I do that in all my shows with my current trio, Rock Gold. You know, you get a chance, and people should check that one out. We got a lot of guests on the Endless High. We got Ian McDonald from King Crimson playing flute on Court of the Crimson King. I came up with the intro on that. That album is all arranged by me, by the way.
Tim made a guest appearance when he was still with us.
Timmy's on Thoughts. The song I wrote that went to number 6 in Italy, and Timmy is on Yolanda, an R&B song that the last two songs of that album features Timmy Bogert on bass.
Right.
Great Tim Bogert.
One of the parts of the book, which I want to bring up, because everything in the book is public knowledge, so I'm not saying anything I shouldn't, was that at a point in your life, when music was no longer supporting you, you went and got a number of regular jobs. And you were a limo driver for a little bit. And you're a delivery guy. And you said one of your fears was that you were going to be in a limo holding a sign. And a guy would say, hey, aren't you Vince Martell for the Vanilla Fudge? And I wonder what's worse, Vince, being recognized or never being recognized?
Exactly. You know, again, I look at it to my faith in the good Lord. And, you know, and the reason why with the Fudge, we had some problems in the book, and I didn't get into it too heavy, is because there were some legal problems, and this happens in probably all phases of business and life, that somebody, you know, next thing, you know, who's mad at you and whatever. And so I had to do some other stuff, and I didn't mind doing it. First of all, I love driving. I had some cool cars in my time, and I was going to college studying for a history degree to teach as a sideline. When things got slow, as they did sometimes in the music business. And a friend of mine who was driving for a limo company suggested, he says, you can make your own hours. You know, it's easy. Right? So whatever it is, I did that. I did a few other things, but I kept the music going. I had my own bands going all the time. And then sure enough, the call started coming in, the public, and the group called again, and they wanted to get me back in. And, you know, so came full circle, but
right.
I thank the good Lord that I was able to do that. I was able to adapt because I haven't been in the Navy and experienced a lot of different stuff in my life. It's not that big. Sometimes you got to switch gears. Come back to what you love when you can. Take a breather.
Well, that goes to show that you're like a chameleon. You do what you got to do to put food on the table and to keep yourself going.
You got it. God bless all the hard workers out there in America that have got to do it all the time.
Absolutely. It takes a special kind of person to be in certain jobs. You mentioned about driving. One thing I got from your book was that you would suddenly lose yourself and think you were Mario Andretti That you must have said 4 or 5 times in this book that you drove your car way past 120 miles an hour and the guardian angels were on your shoulder. Did you learn?
I did learn that you got to be careful when you do it. First of all, the one time in a book that was really not smart for me to do, I went to this party on the South Shore in my Corvette, and I ended up drinking like a jerk for, you know, till I was way past the point of where you should be. And I drove home, and driving back, I was on a Sagicato State Parkway in Long Island about 4 o'clock in the morning or something like that. With the vet was pinned. I had a 411 rear end, so top speed was like 120, but you could get there real fast. So I'm going 120, and with the two eyes open that the good Lord gave me, which is a gift every day when you wake up and you have your two eyes, thank the good Lord, that's a gift he's given you another day. And with my two eyes open, the two lanes was 4. So I had to close one eye to see the two lanes, only two lanes. So now I'm going 120. With one eye closed, you know, on a Sagittarius Parkway. So that's that one. That was really not good. Another time I went past the cops doing 100, switching gears, just cleaning the engine out, you know. Anyway, right. But a lot of crazy stuff.
Right, right. Wow. In 2006, Vanilla Fudge was given a great distinction of being inducted into the Long Island Music Hall of Fame. But there's another Hall of Fame that we need to put our efforts to so that the Fudge could get their rightfully so accolades. We're talking about the Rock Hall, the Rock Hall Hall of Fame. You know, I have no problem with anybody getting into the Hall of Fame if they deserve it. But don't put somebody from 2015 in when you still have people from the 50s, 60s, and 70s who deserve it more.
Very well said, Gene. I totally agree with you. And, you know, a lot of that is politics. There's politics in music like there's politics in everything. And that's what's happening. Who's pulling wood strings and whatever. And, again, we probably, got on somebody's wrong side somewhere along the line. And so they're keeping that string pulled, whatever it is. But I totally agree with you. And they should maybe have a couple of other, like keep rock and roll in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame and maybe put, you know, something else, rap or something, have that kind of a Hall of Fame or something. Let's have some different Hall of Fame for them kind of acts. Because it's kind of, they got everybody in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And like you just said, they don't have some of the 50s groups, some of the 60s groups. Some of the other groups that should be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, according to the fans, you know?
I mean, for the 50s, can you get a bigger songwriter than Neil Sedaka?
Right.
I mean, what more? Neil Diamond was shunned for years.
See, that's ridiculous.
Yeah. So what do we have to do? What do our viewers and listeners have to do to get the Vanilla Fudge on the petition? I know there's a petition out there. Is it available through your website?
I believe it's on my website. And I think that if it's not on my website, it's on the Vanilla Fudge website, which it definitely is on that. Okay. And the other thing I would suggest to all the fans out there and everybody, all the rock and rollers, is besides looking for the petition, look for the petitions. But also, if I may suggest, get a hold of your congressman. Get a hold of the people in government and just write them letters and say, you know, what's going on with this? What's going on with that? Because there's a lot of crazy stuff going on in the world and in the country. And what we should do is let's push for what, you know, we want to do. Because if you don't say nothing, what happens is everybody thinks it's keeping it quiet. And then sometimes you get the negative forces come out and they're asserting themselves. Let's get some of the positive forces to come out and say,
I agree with you. I agree with you. So go on the Vanilla Fudge website, everybody. Sign the petition. If you want to know more about Vince Martell and his solo projects, his rock band, all of his merchandise, go to vincemartell.com. Make sure you get the book. I'm telling you, you get this book, you're going to love it. It's a great read. Great read. Now, I want to go back to the point where you were not a school person. You did not like school.
Right.
So what was your greatest personal achievement? You could say one, two, or all. Was it being recognized and having a musical career? Was it getting through your time as a United States Navy veteran? Or was it going back to college and completing something that you just did not like when you were younger? What was your most rewarding experience?
To be honest with you, I would say everything was my most rewarding experience. I look at life like it's a gift every day the good Lord gives us. And in fact, I got a Bible saying at some point I'd like to say, which I think is be good for the country to hear.
Absolutely.
It was everything together. And the reason is not that, you know, school is not wrong with school if you have, you know, it depends on the curriculum. I don't know about some of the stuff they're coming out with today, but I like the old style curriculum, but I just wasn't ready at that point in my life. I was more into like maybe get into a trade school. I had an uncle that was fantastic mechanic, and I just developed a love for that kind of stuff from hearing him. I ended up, when I did college, I ended up teaching special ed, which actually, that's one of the high points for me, because after I got my degree, I got a job upstate New York, teaching at in Yorktown, BOCES in Yorktown, special ed music teacher, and I got a lot of satisfaction. I got one little girl who never talked in the school. At the end of the year in the library, she sang Twinkle, Twinkle, Little Star to the whole school. Their minds were blown. She had never talked in the school. So that, and I, you know, I'm not patting myself on the back, but my way of teaching is a certain way. Slow down, give them a chance to express themselves. Just like some of the kids were pretty aggravated. They were in the timeout room, was next to the music room. And I would tell them, besides being mad at this teacher and that, what do you love to do? What do you like to do? And then I bring them in and I open up the piano up and let them see the things moving around inside the piano, as opposed to just looking up, you know, something like that. the do re mi's, which is not wrong with it, but some kids, they want to see. Which I was like, I wanted to see things. So special ed, I had another kid that was supposed to be autistic, and this kid could play when I showed him some chords, Beatles stuff, sing and play. He played at the end of the year, blew the school's mind. But it blew out my nightlife, being 8 o'clock in the morning, bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. So, you know, I did that for the 1 year that I did it. But it was very satisfying. And but I thank the good Lord for every opportunity that I've had and all the different things I've done, you know.
You know, Vince, you sound like a guy who went to the top of the mountain. You came down and you're still thankful and you still believe in your heart what you had and what you have now. Too many people dwell on what they don't have anymore. You have a very positive outlook. You're thankful for what you were given. You're thankful for what you have, and you're thankful for what the future brings. And that's with the students, your work with the veterans, your Navy career, your academic career, your musical career. This book was a fascinating, fascinating insight into the life of a rock and roll god, Psychedelic Solo. Now, Vin, if you don't mind, will you get your lovely wife and that beautiful guitar ready? Because we want you to do another little bit of a song for us before we go out. Everybody, please go to vincemartell.com, purchase the book, purchase one of his CDs. You will not be disappointed. Vince, I want to thank you so much for being our guest tonight. Hopefully you had just as much fun as I did.
Oh, I did. I had a great time. Thank you, Gene. I got a couple of Bible sayings I want to wrap out to you with, if I may.
Go ahead.
As far as appreciating everything, let me say that what I said when I was on Mike Huckabee last week, great guy, and this is what I said. It was First Corinthians chapter 2, verse 9, which says, the eye hasn't seen, the ear hasn't heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man the promises God has for those who love him. So there's a whole future out there for us. This life we're passing through, we get to the end of this one, it depends on what you did here, depends on your future. So don't blow it here by being crazy and doing all stupid things and stuff like that. Number two, Second Corinthians. Do you hear an echo over there?
Yeah.
Okay. I think it was my aunt. Second one is Second Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, which says, and this I believe is something that everybody in the United States of America who loves freedom, like I do, and having been proud to have served in the U.S. Navy in the Cuban crisis, is this. Listen to this, the Lord is saying. If my people who are called by my name, the Christians, in other words, will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, got to do that, then, here we go, I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sin, and the big one, I will heal their land. The Lord will heal the land, but you got to come to the Lord. Don't just keep shunning him and pushing him out. Everything you love in life, the Lord has given you. Music, food, sleep, wife, family, animals, beautiful animals that we have. So anyway, that's, you know, a couple of things I wanted to say.
That's great. And I think that's a great segue into a little version of a song that I think we all need. Because why would we want to live in a world without love? So, ladies and gentlemen, Vince and Peg Martell with a song called A World Without Love.
Please lock me away and don't allow the day here inside. There I hide with my loneliness. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love. Birds sing out a tune, and rain clouds hide the moon. I'm okay, here I'll stay with my loneliness. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love. So I'll wait and in a while I will see my true love smile. She may come, I know not when. When she does, I'll lose. Oh baby, until then, lock me away and don't allow the day here inside where I hide with my loneliness. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love. One more time. Say I won't stay in a world without love. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love. I don't care what they say, I won't stay in a world without love.
Vince and Peg Martell, thank you so much. You brought some live concert experience into the room tonight.
Why not? God bless you. And it's true. World without love. We need love in this world.
Absolutely. God bless you. Thank you for your work, past, present, and future. And I hope our paths cross real soon. Ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause.
You too.
God bless
you. Thank you,
Chief. Thank you, guys. Peace out. Wow. What a great interview. See, ladies and gentlemen, only here on Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli do you get an up-to-the-minute sound by some of our guests. And right now, a word from our sponsors.
Hi, my name is Howard, and along with my partner, Karen, we are Cruise Planners Dream Destinations Travel. Contrary to the name, we are a full-service travel agency specializing in individual, multi-generational, and group vacations. Certified with all major cruise lines, we are also represent all resorts and all-inclusives throughout the beautiful Caribbean and Mexico. Let us build your dream vacation. Please call us at 347-398-8653 for a free, no-obligation quote.
Hi, this is Francisco. Many people call me the creative CPA. If you need help with your taxes or financial matters, please email me your cell number and the best time and day to call you. You can email me at francisco@aol.com, and Cisco is spelled S-I-S-C-O, the creative CPA. It's that simple, that easy. Thank you.
Little Italy Auto Repair at 628 Crescent Avenue in the true Little Italy of the Bronx. Over 50 years of automotive service excellence, ASE and state certified, offering all types of services to all types of cars. Discounts to first responders, military, Fordham University students and faculty. All work is done by Victorio with the highest level of quality possible. Telephone number is 718-933-2365 or visit his website at www.littleitalyautobronx.webs.com. That's Little Italy Auto Repair. Thanks to our sponsors. Don't forget, we have a limited number of shirts. Our Reminiscing with Gene DiNapoli t-shirts are available. We have small, medium, large, in black and white. So we are doing that, and we're going to get a new one made up after this. So if you want to get it, please do. Next week's show, an original, a legend, along with his lead vocalist, Johnny Maestro, JT Carter, and his group called The Crests, had some of the biggest hits in doo-wop history. Step by Step, The Angels Listen In, Trouble in Paradise, and the classic 16 Candles. That's next Monday, May 24th at 7 p.m. Ladies and gentlemen, if you enjoy our shows, please listen on ItalianAmericanRadio.com, HamiltonRadio.com. Share our shows and leave a nice comment. We'd love to hear all your views. Until the next week, we see you. God bless you. Stay safe, stay well, stay positive. Take care, everybody.